Okay, I'd like to introduce to you a daughter in the Lord. And this is Miss Ray, Kevin's wife. You would really be excited if you knew what she accomplished in her life. If you knew what she came through. If you know the victories that she'd gotten, you'd really get loud in here.
I don't know about y'all, but I know I am excited because God has brought me and my family through so much that my giving teaching tonight is on gratefulness. Because, you see, I have a lot to be grateful for. Really, all of us in here. If you're in here and you have breath in your body, you have something to be grateful for. And so, you know, it's just gratefulness was on my heart. That was what was on my heart. So the scripture that I have is 2 Corinthians 9:7. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. A cheerful giver. A cheerful giver. Have you ever given something that you really didn't want to part with, but you knew that you were supposed to give it to someone? Yeah, I know, me too. If someone was giving me something, yet I knew that they really didn't want to give it to me, I would really want to be like, why don't you just go ahead and keep that? I mean, unless it's a beach house or something. I'll take that, whether you're reluctant or not. Just give me the beach house, and we'll deal with your reluctantness, you know, later. I'm just kidding, but I'm really not kidding. If you want to give me a beach house, you can definitely do that. But imagine how you would feel if someone were giving you something and you could tell they really didn't want to give it to you. You may want what they're giving you, but you would feel really bad about taking it. And that's the same way that God feels. When we reluctantly give either what we're supposed to give or even what's above that, when he'll tell you, give this or give that. I mean, Candy and Jay gave Candy's car away. That was easy, huh, Jay? it's not always easy, an easy thing. But when God tells you to do it, we got to get it in our hearts that we are cheerful. And so one of the keys to a cheerful giver is gratitude. Because when we have a heart of gratitude, we are happy to give. We are thankful for the things that we could never have achieved on our own, in our own stride. I can tell you this. I always say that God did so much more than I could have imagined. I would have settled for so much less than what God had for me. And so in our own stride, if we realize everything he's given us, we can be thankful. And when we can be thankful, we're in gratitude, and we can be a cheerful giver. And many times it hits me all that the Lord has done, and I can't help but to have such a heart of gratitude, and it makes me want to give of myself. You know, we have kids. We have a business. Sometimes I don't have a whole lot of self to go around. But because I know all that he's done for me, I can't help but give of myself. And with giving of myself, that's giving of my time, which I don't have much of either, and finances, which I'm believing more for. You know, it brings me to this. Every year, I get to this place where every year I get more and more grateful that the Lord spared my husband from death, eternity in hell, and ultimately spared my family from destruction. I mean, listen, today is his birthday. And I'm just telling you that I have something to celebrate. But do you know how much different it would have been for me today had 8 years ago, God not spared him? But I believe that the Lord spared him because he knew that Kevin Ray was not going to shut his mouth about sparing people from the pits of darkness and hell, which awaits all of us if we do not repent and give our lives to Jesus and begin to walk this walk with God. And so every year I get more and more grateful. Maybe it's the older I get, you know, I hate to admit that, but let's just be real. Every year we get older. Okay. So many people have been touched by your testimony, Kevin, of what God has done in your life, and it's touched so many other lives. And I'm so grateful that you're here tonight and that you're able to share what God has done. I'm grateful that I'm not sitting at a gravesite mourning you or what should have been. And listen, we all have tragedy hit our lives. Every single person in here can think of a tragedy that has hit your life. But as I said, if you have breath in your body, there is something to be grateful for. I'm sure you have children, parents, a spouse, a house, a car. You have all these things. And of course, those are things to be grateful for, but they are also temporal. The real thing to be grateful for is our salvation. Salvation. If we lost every temporal thing in this world, yet we have Jesus, we have everything. So, in our gratitude lies a cheerful giver. And I just want to say, if you sit under the teachings in this church of giving week after week, and you squirm in your seat and you say, when is this going to be over? I think you need to find something to be thankful for so that you can be a cheerful giver. I'm telling you, it's for you. We don't teach at this church about giving for the church. Of course, the church needs finances. But if this church would not have taught me about giving, I wouldn't know about giving. And so if you have a hard time struggling in giving or in sitting in the messages, try to focus on something to be thankful for. Throughout the years of good and bad, we've had good and bad, but we never went without. God always provided. He always provided. And I believe a lot of that has to do with what we've learned from this church about giving. There is nothing that I would not give to this ministry because it is good ground. These pastors, they do the right thing with every dollar that's brought to this house. And so I really believe that is what attributes a lot to what our success has been in our business, in our lives, in our ministry. So I guess the bottom line is find a place of gratitude to the Father. And I promise you that you will become a cheerful giver. Psalm 36:7, how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. That alone should make you cheerful. We serve a big God. So, Pastor, you want to come on up here? And
thank you, John. You did great. Y'all know the lady in the Bible, the Canaanite woman that came to the table that Jesus was at with the disciples. And Jesus really dissed her out. He actually called her a dog. He didn't answer her. He didn't answer her questions. The disciples were pushing back, telling her to shut up. And Jesus finally said, listen, the bread that I have is to fill the children. That's the Israelites, those chosen by God. And that lady persisted and pressed in. And she said, Lord Jesus, even the dogs eat the crumbs. And she said, she knew she couldn't sit at the table. She was not there yet. She was in a process of getting where she needed to be. And I remember years ago, Kevin was that person. He couldn't get to where he needed to be. Matter of fact, he came in this church and saw what we were doing, but he was not in the place to do what we were doing. But he had an eagerness. He had a desire to do something big for God. And I watched Kevin for many years. He just ate crumbs. Whatever he had, he used it for the glory of God. Whatever God dished out to him, he was thankful for it, John 2. And I know in Kevin's heart, this is what he was saying. Lord, if you ever get me out of what I put myself in, I'm going to serve you. I'll take what you give me right now. I'll take the crumbs. I'll take the low position. I'll take the place that nobody else wants to take. But if you get me out of what I put myself in, you won't have to beg me to come to church. You won't have to beg me to give. You won't have to beg me to witness. You won't have to beg me to preach. You won't have to beg me to do anything. I'm submitted to you, and I will do whatever you tell me to do. That's where he is right now. Came through the process, and I am so thankful. He's a man of God. He's got his hands in people's lives. He's a servant in this house. He's anybody ever got ministered to by Kevin in this place? There you go. There you go. Touching people all over the place. So I'm proud with John. Yeah. To invite my son in the Lord, a pastor in this church, a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Kevin Ray. Amen. Hey! Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And listen, it's his birthday. And listen, I cannot sing happy birthday to everybody in church. I never do it. Because if you sing it for one person, you got to sing it to everybody. So I never sing happy birthday. But I'm singing happy birthday to Kevin. And so if you don't like it, you can leave now. I may not sing your happy birthday in this church, but I'm singing it to Kevin right now. So let's do it. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Kevin. Happy birthday to you. Woo!
Well, hallelujah! Yeah. Glory to God. What a way to end a birthday, eh? Sound like I'm from Canada, eh? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Amen. Father, yes, Lord. We wait on your precious Holy Spirit. Lord, I thank you that we are led and we are guided by the Spirit of might. I thank you, Lord, that you have a plan and a purpose here tonight, that you are not going to leave us orphans tonight. But you are going to impart to us a truth, a dynamic, God, that is going to cause us to break free from the things that have held us. Tonight we're going to a new location in you. By your might, Lord, we pray that we're going to be elevated over the circumstances, over what the enemy has thrown our way. I declare tonight that the cycles are going to be broken. I thank you, Father, that truth is going to come forth like a Mack truck, and it's going to break the enemy and the lies into pieces tonight, God. We can say that because we believe in a mighty God. We believe in a spirit of might in this place. And God, I declare your love over each heart tonight, that it's just not about it's freedom so that we can be loved and that we can love. So, Lord, we invite you in this place to have your way. Lord, I pray tonight that you'll speak through me and that this testimony that has happened to me will be spoken explicitly and accurately exactly how it happened. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One day I was waiting on the pizza delivery guy to come to my house. And as I was waiting on the front porch for him to come, I'm thinking in my mind, what can I tell him about Jesus that's going to get his attention? And as he was coming up the steps, I looked at him straight in the eye and I said, friend, I said, what if hell is real? What would you do? How would you react? How would you live? How would it change you if you really understood and had a revelation knowledge that there is a real place called hell that exists. And the man was speechless. And what I realized at that moment was that we really don't like to think about it. That human beings do not want to think about. They don't even want their imaginations to go there. And as a result of it, today, the church in America doesn't preach on hell anymore. Yes, we've gotten overboard with that message in the past, but I'm telling you today, I believe there's going to be a resurgence of ministers with an anointing to talk about, to preach about, to explicitly explain that there is a real hell. I believe that with my whole heart tonight. No one can talk me out of that. The place is really there. It's there. It's all throughout Scripture. Jesus talked more about hell than he did about heaven. And so if Jesus talked more about hell than heaven, why do we talk more about heaven than hell? Because I'm going to tell you why. Because with the revelation of hell comes inconvenience. With the revelation of hell means I got to carry a responsibility that I have to tell others that it's a real place. And it makes me uncomfortable. It takes me out of my comfort zone. That's why it's not preached here in America anymore. It's because it comes with responsibility. There's a weight that comes with it. But I'm going to tell you all tonight that we have a responsibility to talk about it to the lost. We have a responsibility to wrestle with people, with their souls, to lay our lives down, because something we know, something's been revealed to us through Scripture. We know if you're born again and you're in this place tonight, you know in your heart that there's a real hell because the Holy Spirit has revealed it to you. Now, you may not understand the capacity of suffering that is there, but it's there. And you know somewhere deep inside, it's awful. It's bad. But you really don't understand because we don't have the capacity to understand just how awful it is. Hell is a real place. And if hell is a real place, who goes there? Who qualifies for that place? I think there's a lot of misconception around that. Who goes there? Because I never thought I would have went there. I got saved in 1999, man. I did. I got radically saved. God did a work in me, man. I remember the Brownsville revival in 1999. I met this man, Pastor Butch. Let me tell you how good God is tonight. God is seeking you out like a heat-seeking missile. Amen. God is looking for a way to divinely interrupt your life. God is looking and strategizing to put someone in your path that's going to tell you about hell. God is looking for a way that he might save you and bring you into sanctification. It's like a heat-seeking missile, man. Your father loves you so much. He's strategizing. He's planning. He's putting divine appointments in front of you. And he did that to me with this man right here. You see, I was only exposed to religion. I thank God for the Catholic Church. I thank God that I heard the name Jesus in that church because it brought me meditation. It brought me into a place to think about God. But I didn't know how to get free from drugs and alcohol, man. It crept into my life when I was 14 years old. Alcohol led to marijuana. Marijuana led to cocaine. And before you know it, by the age of 17, I'm basically a full-blown addict. One other good thing happened when I was 17. You see, God's got a plan. Even though the enemy has a plan to destroy you, God's got a plan to save you. Every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, whom there's no variation or shadow of turning. You are my gift from God. She is my gift. God knew I needed a warrior to stand with me through the years of testing and trial. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. There's a real spiritual world, a real spiritual realm that is after your soul. And they'll do anything to get you. They're strategizing, they're looking, they're planning, they're plotting. But God always has a ram in the bush. He always does. In 1998, three people in one day told Pastor Butch about a man named Kevin Ray. How often that happens? You hear one person's name you never heard before three times. How many of y'all think God loves us? Amen? Because I couldn't help myself. I needed a God that could. How many of y'all know the scripture says when a strong man comes upon you, you need someone stronger than you to break that power off of you? Man, I needed the strength of Jesus Christ to set me free. But I didn't know how to get to him. I knew about religion. I knew about the Baptist church. I knew about the Catholic church. What I didn't know about was the power of the Holy Ghost. And I saw it in a man and a woman who loved God. And it drew me to them. In 1999, he brought me to a place called the Home of Grace. And I went on a three-month journey there. And I experienced God, man. It was beautiful, wonderful. But I didn't understand the fight that was still ahead. I didn't understand just because I made a commitment and a confession and I wanted to change, there was still a war for my soul going on that I didn't know and I wasn't prepared. So God put me in a place that people could rally around me, people that knew more than me, people that were sold out for Jesus, radically on fire for God. I'm so thankful I found this church. I'm so thankful I'm right here in this place in Addis, Louisiana. This day, my birthday. God is good. Man, I wouldn't have, you understand, I wouldn't have made it in a dead church. You understand me? I needed the power of a radical fire to work inside of me to break those shackles off of me. And so in 1999, I began my journey. And I'm going to tell you, hey, she tells me that. She's always like, hey, Theobug. 1999, I began my journey with the Lord. And after being clean for about 5 months, I opened the door. We moved, my wife and I, we were living together for 9 years. We had my oldest son, Blake, and we wasn't married. And so when you living in that lifestyle, you give the enemy a legal right to torment you. You give the enemy legal access to your mind, your will, and your emotions. And that's what happened, man. Condemnation came in, and I fell back into sin after being clean for 5 months, man. And then that pattern just kind of took a life of its own. And for the next 7-8 years, I kept getting in this place where I would get clean and get on fire for God, man. And I'm telling you, I'd be going up and down the streets telling everybody about Jesus. I'm in love with this Christ, this man Jesus. You got to meet him. And then 3 months later, I'm back in the crack house. It almost didn't make sense. You see, I discovered something in that. In those years, I discovered three things that an addict needs to be free. The first thing is he needs to be willing. If you're not willing to make a change and willing to do whatever it takes, I'm telling you, the enemy's going to run roughshod over you. Yes. And that goes for anything, not just an addict. Yes. No matter what you're struggling with, you've got to be willing to do whatever it takes. I'm telling you, we interview men to come into the restoration house, and I'll ask them the question. I'm going to say, do you want to change? And mostly, 9 out of 10 will say yes, but about 4 out of 10 will say yes to this question, which is, are you willing to do whatever it takes to change? And see, I wasn't at that place where I was willing to do whatever it took. I wanted it, but I just wasn't quite there. How many of y'all know it's a process? Yeah. There's a process that goes, and God is so gracious. I'm not saying it's God's best. I've seen people that encounter Jesus, boom, and they free right away. They never turn back. They never go back. That wasn't me. You see, the second thing was, I didn't want to take any pain. See, the mindset of an addict is he doesn't like pain. That's why I took pain pills, because I don't like pain, okay? Whether it's emotional, physical, any kind of pain, I took something to medicate that. So I had to learn how to take pain. I'm being real with you right now. If you want to get free from sin, if you're caught in the cycle of sin, you got to just take your licks sometimes. I'm thinking about the scripture with Abraham and God in the 17th chapter of Genesis. He says, Abraham, I'm about to bless you. He says, but wait, you need to get circumcised first. You know what he was saying? Put some skin in the game, baby. We got to put some skin in the game. If you want to be free from sin, it's got to cost you something. Okay? And at that point, I wasn't willing to pay it what the cost was. Because sometimes to refrain from doing what my flesh wants to do, it's painful. But how many of y'all know it's worth it? He's worth it! Yeah! I'm telling you. Oh, the pain of discipline yields the love and the rewards of heaven. We've been in a fast for a few days. And man, I'm telling you, I buffet this flesh because I got to be ready to take some pain, because I know anytime we plan an outreach, anytime we do something big for the church, we let an outreach downtown Plaquemine, and we probably presented 500 people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Last summer, 324 people gave their lives or confessed Jesus as Lord. How many of y'all know that didn't come with just tulips and daisies, all right? You understand? When I'm preparing for that, when I'm getting ready to do something for God, there's all out hell coming against me. Okay, so you got to be ready to take some pain on. Right on? How y'all like that? Right on? Right on? Straight from the 70s, huh? Third thing I learned was that if you're going to get free and stay free, no matter what it is, but specifically I'm talking about my addiction, was you got to know the Word of God, man. You got to know the Word. I'm telling you, it really comes down to that. The other two are really substandard to knowing the Word. The Bible says that we should live by every word that proceeds from God. And that's the sustenance. That's the life that's able. How should a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to the Word. So for 8.5 years, I went through this chamber of just, man, you would think, okay, I don't know if you realize this, but when my wife, my pastor, my family would see me living my life for God, heck, I even got to a place where I was working with the youth. You remember that, huh, Rebecca? I was working with the youth, and God's anointing, His blessing, everything was on me. And then to walk away from that, how many of y'all know some people were disappointed because I walked right back into sin? I don't think we realize and understand. Even me, I forget. In that 8.5 years, it was all out hell, man. I'd walk into this church after going use crack or use cocaine. I walk in this church, man, and it would be the most embarrassing thing for me. It would take every fiber of my being to walk back into this place knowing that there was dirt all over me. Filth. Perversion. It was just corroding all over me. But I'd still come because I needed to be healed. I wanted to change. And I knew that it was going to be Jesus that was going to do it. Something just kept pulling me back, pulling me back, and pulling me back. And through that 8.5 years, pastor had to cast out demons, get me out of crack houses, chase me down the road, call police. It was drama filled. I'm going to just tell you, we could produce a movie on that 8.5 years of time. Really a bestseller right there. I'm telling you. Just 8.5 years. I remember Tony. 2 years before this hell experience. 2 years. Two weeks. 2 weeks before the hell experience, I was tweaking in the parking lot. Those of you that are ex-addicts, y'all know what I'm talking about when I say tweaking. I'm tweaking in the parking lot, going through my glove box, right? And so the police, in case y'all don't know, Rusty, came outside to check me out and see what I was doing. But then Tony came too. And so I remember this. I never forget this, Tony. You told me this. The Holy Ghost showed me you about to die. You about to die. If you don't change, you are about to die. I had people calling me in the hotel room saying, hey, the Lord just gave me a vision. If you don't stop, you're going to die. I had multiple people have dreams, visions of me in caskets, of me dead, over and over. I'd be trying to get buzzed out in the hotel, and some crazy intercessor would call me, find me, and said, hey, the Lord just said. I'm like, no! Just ruined my high. Just ruined it. And I'd be knowing, man. I'd be knowing the Lord. How y'all like that English? I'd be knowing. I'd be knowing. I went up in a hotel one time, and I'll never forget this, man. I walked in the hotel. This is how God was dealing with me. And he starts speaking to me. Stuff I never heard before. I'm like, what was that? I heard a voice. I'm looking under the pillows and the sheet. You know when you're tweaking, you tweak us. Man, you don't know what. So I heard a voice, and it said, Zerubbabel. I said, what in the heck is a Zerubbabel? So I knew the Bible says my sheep know my voice, and they will not follow another. So I got on the phone with the crazy intercessor lady that called me before. I said, hey. I said, what is a Zerubbabel? And she went on to tell me the famous scripture in Zechariah that says it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. Even when I was out and away and doing the wrong thing, God was still in pursuit of me. Isn't he a good God? El Shaddai, King of glory. The same God that caused Peter to walk on water, that caused Lazarus to come out of the grave, is the same God that touched my life and changed me. Oh, I'm excited about Jesus. I have a lot to be excited about. I almost died. So after an 8.5-year journey, you know, just back and forth, back and forth, I got to a place where, y'all, I didn't want to live anymore. I just didn't care. You know, no one really, and I'm not saying what the drug addict does is right, okay? Because it's all wrong what he does, okay? But I want you to understand something tonight, that the drug addict is really under layers of condemnation and guilt, depression, oppression. There are layers. The drug addict's disgusted with himself or herself. He can't. It gets to a point where you can't even stand yourself anymore. I couldn't even stand being in my own body. I didn't want to live anymore. I could not take. My heart could not take the disappointment, the discouragement, the hurt that I saw in everybody else's eyes. I wanted to die. But I didn't understand and know what that meant. I didn't know if you died in that state that you don't get to go to heaven. You know, I had a friend who used to say, we would always wonder, well, man, we got saved and we'd go out and smoke crack, huh? He's like, man, I don't think Jesus is going to come get me if I got a crack pipe in my mouth. I was like, you're right. I don't want to do that. I don't want to try that. We don't, when you're truly born again and you're truly saved within, man, you don't want to do anything that's going to hurt him, harm him, or devastate. It's a relationship. 2008, February the 16th, I came home from a 3-day binge, and I'll never forget walking in that trailer. John said to me, she says, you better not have dope on you. And of course, the addict lies. I ain't got no dope. I'm straight. And so, but really, I was so disgusted, and so in despair. I didn't want to live anymore. And after three days of using cocaine, that night, probably about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, I was laying on my sofa, and I wanted, every bit of me wanted to die. It was like I was almost on a suicide mission, because I didn't want to live anymore. And the weird thing was, that night I heard a voice speak to me. Now, I suspect it was the voice of the enemy. However, it seems like it's turned out for good. I heard this voice say to me, do one more line and you will never have to worry again. Yeah. And you know what I did? I did it. And immediately when I did it, now you got to understand, I'd been using drugs, using cocaine for about 15 years. I never had any kind of anxiety attack, heart attack, anything like that. I'd been doing it for so long, I knew where to stop. But this time, there was just something in me that just kept pushing me towards doing more and more and more. And when I did it, I immediately, now this has never happened to me. I know this happens with a lot of heroin addicts, people that are coming off of heroin, or black out and then come back. But in the world of cocaine, that doesn't happen often. When somebody blacks out on cocaine, that's it. It's done. I mean, normally they're blacking out because their heart is going into cardiac arrest, and that's it. You don't normally come back from that. And so that night when I did it, I blacked out immediately. And I don't know, only but by the grace of God, some kind of way from the living room sofa, Jean was taking a bath, it was probably 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. In a blackout state, I saw walls just appear to me. I don't know exactly how to explain this, but I went from a physical realm to a spiritual realm real quick. And when I was walking through these walls in the dimension that I was in, and all the while, my printer was falling off the, I must have been struggling to get to the back, because I was walking towards love, the only thing I knew on this earth that was love. I was walking towards her because it was a safe place. And I knew I had done something that there was no turning back. I knew it in myself. And so when I came to, I opened my eyes and she is in the casement of the bathroom looking at me. I could see the look on her face that I was in big trouble. I didn't go in, because the fear, the look. And shortly thereafter, I went unconscious. I believe that, well, I think we struggled to the bedroom, and I fell on the floor, and she was holding me while I was on the floor, and I went unconscious. And we estimate that the time of unconsciousness was about 2 to 4 minutes. I believe that I was in cardiac arrest. This is what I think, because of what I felt. I felt like the heart attack victims talk about the elephant on your chest. They talk about your left arm going numb. It was like all of that stuff was happening to me in that moment, but I went unconscious. But only when I went unconscious, I would come into a spiritual consciousness. And so I remember when that happened, immediately, it was like these four dark shadows came up and grabbed me, and it was this vacuum that was pulling me downward. Hell is in the earth. Hell is below. The scripture says it, but I'm telling you, it became a reality to me. There was like nothing I could do to stop the descent, the pull, the vacuum, and I'm just like being sucked out of my body. I remember reaching back for my wife. I'm reaching back for her. And I'm being pulled into this place, and it was like a tunnel I was in, and they were dragging me down, and it was like going really, really fast, and it was dark, and then we get to this like this hole, and there was like a chamber. It was like this huge room. I could not see the ceiling in it. It was just so high, and the walls were made like clay but iron, and they were very dark and hard, like a substance I've never seen before on planet Earth. It was something different. It was very eerie at that moment. But you know something? At that moment, I knew what was happening. I knew. I remember thinking, my wife is going to think I'm in heaven because I professed Christ. Because I knew Jesus, because I knew the word, because I preached the word, because I lived the word at one time, that she's going to think that I'm in heaven and reaching back for her. And I just couldn't grab it. I cannot even begin to tell you just the separation from what you know is good and right and pure and love, what that torment is like. I could spend the rest of my time right now telling you just about that. In eternity, when you cross over, whether you go to heaven or hell, your capacity of reasoning, your capacity of understanding is going to be amplified beyond anything that you have ever understood or discovered on this earth. And the reason for that is because you live your body in a flesh. And when you drop this flesh off, your spiritual understanding is going to be amplified. It's kind of like when we fast. When we fast, it's like Pastor said it the other day, it's like a mini rapture. You're so sensitive to the things of the Spirit. It's like your capacity gets bigger. And it's like that when you cross over into eternity. Immediately, you know. It wasn't like somebody had to tell me, I'm getting ready, I'm fitting to go to hell, okay? I knew what was about to happen to me, and I could feel the horror gripping my heart in such a way that words wouldn't even describe to you what it's like to be separated from everything that you know and you love. People call this earth hell. They have missed it. This place is not hell. You don't understand. There's people that love you here. There's people that'll do anything for you here. There's a church. There's a Holy Spirit. In that place, there's none of that. None of it. Woo! There's only destruction and torment and your worst nightmare come to life. And even that doesn't describe it, the feeling that I had in my heart. It doesn't do it justice. And so I was chained to a wall. Y'all, I'm not trying to establish any kind of doctrine. I'm not trying to do Bill Weiss's testimony. I'm doing Kevin Ray's testimony, all right? I didn't see any fire. I didn't see any flames or anything like that. I'm just telling you what changed my life tonight, okay? The things that I saw that changed my life. And so I'm put in this place and I'm chained to a wall, this wall. And I remember feeling what hopelessness feels like. I remember we got hope, man. We have hope here. I remember feeling what being unloved feels like. I remember many of the faculties and many of the things that manifested in me in addiction alive in that moment. Many of the things that I struggled with, the depression, the oppression, all the stuff was upon me and it was amplified even at a greater level. It still had life. It was still alive. The things that torment you here, their purpose is to bring you there. That's what they're for, is to bring you into that place. And it's only going to be worse. It's only going to be greater, the torment in that place. And so I'm there on the wall, and I remember, God, I remember being so angry. There's a scripture that says there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I remember being so angry. And check this out. I wasn't so angry at me as much as I was angry at God. In that moment, the God that I love and the God that I serve, the God that I wanted to be a part of, in that moment, there was so much. I was gritting my teeth because I was so angry. It reminded me of the time that I wanted freedom. And I remember I was in my trailer where we were living, and I picked up the bar. I was so mad and so angry. The supernatural anger came on me, and it was the same thing there. I was so angry with God. And I remember thinking, I never get to go back and do it over. It's over. Man, I didn't make my life count. I didn't influence anybody for eternity. I didn't do good to my fellow man. I didn't preach Jesus. I lived for myself. I was a selfish man. And here are the results. And there was nothing I could do. I couldn't go back and make it right. All the potential that was in me, all of the good, all of the intentions that were in me, done me no good whatsoever. We always have a saying around here, potential will get you fired. Potential will get you in hell. Because if you lean on your potential, there's so many people that are not in church right now, and they think they're good people, and they're walking around out there with the form of godliness, but they're really, really not giving themselves to the Christ. And they think in their mind they're going to be there in glory on the streets of gold. And I'm telling you tonight, I don't believe that for one moment. Maybe you have a different doctrine, but I'm just telling you from my experience, I remember thinking there was going to be people there that didn't expect to be there. You talk about the fear of the Lord right there. Pastor, that's what's going to return to our church. The fear of God. That's what we need. We need the fear of God. We need to understand there's a real hell. There's a place of suffering and torment that if we don't tell them, if we don't open our mouth, a lion doesn't need to be defended. He just needs to be let out. How many of y'all know the word is the lion? How many of y'all know? The lion of the tribe of Judah needs to come out of our mouth. That's why our lips are always under attack. Always. For you to shut up and don't say nothing. Should I share with them? How many times do you think about that? How many times do you walk by the person who's in the wheelchair? How many times do you feel in your heart that you should share Jesus with somebody and we don't? Why? Because our tongue is under attack by hell. Because the enemy knows if we start speaking, if we start sharing, if we start releasing the power and the word of God, hell is going to retreat off of that person. That's what happened to me. Every time the word was preached, hell would retreat. It's time for us to step up and step out. I'm not saying that. Well, I am saying that. We need to step out. And so in this place of suffering and torment, I remember looking at my flesh and my skin was translucent. I could see through my body. I had skin, but it was like an invisible layer on me. I was coated in this thing. And I specifically remember being in this place, looking right down here, and it was clear, and I could see there was darkness right here in my belly. There was a black mass in my stomach right here. And no one had to tell me. I knew what it was. You want me to tell you what it was? It was sin. It lived in my soul. It lived in my spirit. The choices that I made darkened the very core of who I was by the choices that I made. I'm going to tell you, that's the contract agreement that Satan has with people. They make a choice to sin, and when you sin, you make a contract or a covenant with the devil. The Bible says he that sins is of the devil. Some people say that, well, no. I don't believe in all of that. It don't matter. You sin, your soul is darkened, and when you breathe your last breath, the devils are coming, the demons are coming. They have a contract with you, and they're coming get you, and they're going to bring you to a place you don't want to be. I'm telling you, that's the truth. If you continue in sin and do not repent, you give hell legal right over you. It's time we start preaching that again in the church. Yeah. It's time we start preaching the message of hell. Now, it takes an anointing to do that because we'll get religious and get crazy with it, okay? The reason we preach hell is to amplify the love of God, baby. That's why we preach hell, because we want to show how much. You want to see the greater capacity of God's love? You start talking about hell. Then people understand what they're delivered from. Yeah. See, my only goal to preach hell is not to condemn people, but to give them the love of Jesus. So they know there's a real God that loves them, died for them, paid the price for them. Amen. And in this place, man, I realize that this darkness that's in me is the contract agreement with hell. And there's nothing I can do about it. It was awful. Unbearable. It's the best way I can describe it, but the thing is, you get a capacity to bear it. And that's what I had. There's nothing pure in that place that I experienced, in that moment I experienced. There's nothing pure. It's evil concentrate. If you can imagine every hellish thing that's on the earth. If you think about the mass murderers, like the guy that shot up all those people in Orlando. You think about the guy in California. Your old timers like Manson and Dahmer were eating people. You know, we look at that and we say, wow, that's evil. Let me tell you something. That is nothing compared to the purity and the concentrate of evil that's in hell. There are barriers on the earth. The barriers on the earth, first, is the Holy Ghost. The second barrier is the Church of Jesus Christ. The third barriers are the laws of the land. There's no Jesus. There's no Holy Ghost. There's no law. Are you hearing me? And there's no Church of Jesus Christ there. So they can do what they want. They have complete access to do whatever they want to the highest regards. As a matter of fact, it's their job to torment you. The scripture talks about where the worm never dies. The worm just goes in and out. In and out. The worm is alive and it just eats. It just eats you. It eats. I've been so many people who have had encounters with hell. Of course, after my experience, I researched a bunch of them and watched a lot of the videos and the testimonies. And I'm going to tell you, I'll look at them and I'll know which ones that I feel like are real because it'll bear witness with my spirit. And I've heard many of them. And I'm going to tell you, maybe it's time that we as the church start listening to those so that we'll get stirred up about eternity. Hallelujah. So I'm in this place of just complete, utter suffering and going through. I mean, it's amazing. The emotions were there. The mind was there. Thoughts, remembrance, everything was there in that moment. And I felt, from my toes to my head, like a fire go through my body. It was so much pain. The best way I can describe it is if I wanted to become one with a hair follicle on my pinky toe, I could feel the hair follicle on fire. I could become one with the hair follicle on my pinky toe. This kind of stuff just doesn't come to a man. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if any of you have had experiences or encounters like that, but I never had anything like this happen to me, even to the point that I could understand, rationalize, and explain to you these things that I'm telling you. I believe hell is real. I believe it with my whole heart. And I believe the evidence of it for me is a man that couldn't stay clean, couldn't get free. From a glimpse of hell, God has changed me. That's the proof in the pudding. That's it. And God has had mercy and he spared me so that I would go out and be a trumpet and tell others and warn others and tell them there's a real hell, but there's a God that loves you. Just repent and give him your life. And so there, I'm in this awful pain, man. And I don't know where, man, but out of my heart flew a river of water. I start preaching the word of God in hell. I don't know why, but it just came out of me. In that moment, I started preaching, and scriptures were coming out of my heart. And all of a sudden, I heard a voice speak to me. And here's what the voice told me. This voice still rings in my ear today. I will never, ever forget this voice. And what he said, and this is what he told me. He said, "This is your last chance." Immediately, my eyes opened up. I'm looking at my son, Blake, giving me mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, 14 years old at the time, trying to get breath and air into my body. I got my son laid out. I'm screaming to the top of my lungs. I've been in hell. I've been in hell. The paramedics are coming in the house. I'm grabbing them dudes. I'm like, hell is real. Hell is real. Repent before it's too late. It's real. So they get me, man. They blow me up on the gurney, the stretcher. Man, they take me to the hospital. My mother-in-law rode with me. Man, I just, you know, and that ambulance ride, I remember from my house to River West, which was like 5 minutes, maybe less, maybe 2 minutes. I remember it was like a flood of revelation came to me. There were so many things that the Holy Spirit spoke to me in that time, that little bit of time before I got to the emergency room. That's still in my heart today that I've still not told anyone, for such a time as this or for such a time to come. And so, man, they get me at the hospital, and they roll me in there. And I'm like belligerent, y'all. I'm like, hey, hell is real. They're like, what is wrong with this guy, man? I'm grabbing the nurses. Hell is real. The police are still in there because they came search the house. That's what they do when somebody's, you know, drugging. And so the police are still in the emergency room. I'm telling him hell is real. I get on the phone. I call a judge from Plagman. I'm like, hell is real. He's like, what? I said, hey, look, let me tell you, man. Something just happened to me. Now, he knew I was struggling with drugs because I would talk to him. And he would always say, go see Butch LeBeau. I'm like, you can't help me. He's like, no, go to Butch LeBeau. Well, you know, when you done spun all your plates and you ain't got no way. So anyway, he's like, I'm like, hey, man. I'm like, dude, you ain't going to believe what happened to me. I'm going through the whole thing. He said, and I'm thinking he's about to laugh at me, mock me. He says, tell me more. You don't understand. There was so much conviction and passion in my voice because I believed in my heart what I saw. Grabbing the doctors. Hell is real. Hell is real. I'm like, this dude's a lunatic up in here. The River West didn't know what to do with me. So some kind of way, Pastor Butch comes. 7 o'clock in the morning, the man of God shows up. And I'll never forget what you said to me, Pastor. This is what you said. You said, Kevin, I believe you. And you'll get to share this testimony one day. And Pastor, we've shared it all over the world, huh? All over the world. Wow. Any good. But then Pastor says, time to shut up. They about to put you in a straitjacket. They were getting the straitjacket ready. They were like getting it ready. They was about to put it on me. But you don't understand what I saw. Put a radical fire on the inside of me. They need to know. Hell is real. It's a real place. It's time, church. It's time we wake up. It's time we wake up. Our prayer need to reflect that people are going to hell. Our walk in our businesses need to reflect that people are going to hell. Our walk in the supermarket needs to reflect people are dying, going to hell. We are the church of Jesus Christ. It's not somebody else's job. It's our job to tell them. Let me just tell you tonight, I don't know where you are in your life, but sin is not worth it. From what I've seen, what I've experienced personally, the one thing I can tell you, I'm not perfect, okay? In no way. But I run from sin. I run from it. I don't play with sin. I don't try to say, oh, I'm a big man. I'm going to go in that ballroom and get them all saved. No, I ain't going in there unless the Holy Ghost comes on me. And then I might not even go. I might have to have my wife too. I run from sin. Amen. That's right. I run from it. It ain't worth it, man. That's right. It ain't worth it. I was talking to a man Monday night, and I was sharing my testimony. This testimony I shared with you tonight in a quicker version, about a 10-minute version. And I was telling him, I said, okay. So after I presented my testimony, I said, if you died today, sir, if you died, where would you go? And he looks me straight in the eye and he says, I would go to hell. I said, does that concern you? You know what he said to me? Nah. I said, friend, the reason it doesn't concern you is because you don't know what's there. You don't understand the torment and the suffering and what's going to come upon you. You don't have a revelation. You don't understand. Hell is real. And so I just kept wrestling with his soul. Why? Because I know something. I can't just let him go. I wrestled with him. Church, it's time that we wrestle with people's souls, man. Now I'm praying that this year is a year that God, by his grace, we're going to step into a realm that we're going to be able to wrestle with a man's soul. You know, it's got to be by the Spirit. I mean, you just can't go, you know, doing all this work in the arm of the flesh. You need to be prayed up. You need to catch a revelation of the compassion of Jesus for people who are dying and going to hell. Because if you go out there and pull a Moses, man, I'm telling you, it's just not going to be good. Y'all know what I'm saying? Moses, when he got the revelation, he went and killed the Egyptian, you know. He did it all in the flesh. God wants to consecrate us. He wants to sanctify us. He wants us to walk pure and holy before him so that he can use us as a mouthpiece. Amen. Now is the time. It's now. Hell is not playing with us. The enemy wants our children. The enemy wants our community. I go in this store over here and there's pipes and all this stuff. The community, they don't care about our kids, man. We've got to rise up in righteousness and put a stop to it. When will we step up? When will we say, hell, that's it. You're not coming in my city. You're not coming in Addis, Louisiana. This city, this town is dominated by Jesus Christ. That can only happen if we rise up and say enough is enough. Hell's not going to have its way in my community right here. As long as I'm here, God, sanctify me, help me, give me the grace so that I can reach out to this community and let them know about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. God is good.
Yes.
He's good. He's good that he would save me. He would save us. He would bring us to this place right now. Now we can experience each other. We can experience heaven right now. Let me tell you something tonight, guys. I really know in my heart, if you'll allow the fear of God to come upon you right now, God's going to do miraculous things in you. I think all of us, me included, in this house tonight, need to get to a place in our life where we're constantly in repentance before God, because we have fallen short of the glory of God. And I feel like in my heart tonight, there's an anointing here. There's a gift here for repentance. No matter where you are, no matter how long you've been walking with Jesus, maybe you don't even know Jesus, but tonight it starts right here. One of the greatest revivals that ever hit this nation was the Brownsville Revival. And at the Brownsville Revival, there was a revival of repentance that yielded the fruit of God. And I truly believe with my whole heart, the revival that's coming to this nation is going to be a revival of repentance. That's going to be the front runner of the revival. It's going to be repentance. When the church says, you know what? I've been in sin, and it's time for me to repent and get right with God. Would you jump your feet with me tonight?